let's give God a hand clap of praise this morning. How many are happy to be here this morning? How many are glad that God woke us up this morning? Because this is a day that the Lord has made, and let us rejoice and be glad in it. The Bible, the scripture says, oh, taste and see the goodness of the Lord. How many know that God is good today? As I was preparing for this first song, it's called The Move of God, and I looked it up and it said what the Bible means when they say a move of God. And it said when people are awakened by for the need of the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. How many of y'all awoke? How many of y'all awoke in here today? So I want y'all to get on your feet and praise with me. The song is called A Move of God, because the move of God is on the way. Put your hands together. Turn it up. We've come for a move of God. We've come for the Holy One. All we want, all we hunger is for you. We've come with expectant hearts, undone, knowing who you are. For you know what you can do. Holy Spirit, come alive. Fire on the altar, fresh wind blowing through. We come to stay here till we encounter you. Make us a blessing offering. Make us an upper room. We're gonna stay here till we encounter you. Tear our idols down. We're repenting. This is still your house. You meant it when you said you pour your spirit out. Holy Spirit, come alive. Fire on the altar, fresh wind blowing through. We come to stay here till we encounter you. Make us an offering, make us an upper room. We come to stay here till we encounter you. Till we encounter you. Till we encounter you. This next part says we need a move of God. I want y'all to sing it with me. We need a move of God. That's it. We need a move of God. We need a move of God. We're hungry, we're desperate. Lord, open the heavens. We need a move of God. We need a move of God. We need a move of God. We're hungry, we're desperate. Lord, open the heaven. Let's sing it again. We need a move of God in this church. And our hearts. We're hungry, we're desperate. Lord, open the fire on the altar. Fire on the altar, fresh wind blowing through. We come stay here till we encounter you. Make us an offering, make us an upper room. We come stay here till we encounter you. Fire on the altar, fresh wind blowing through. We come stay here till we encounter you. Make us an offering, make us an upper room. We gonna stay till we encounter you. We need a move of God. We need a move of God in our home. We need a move of God in our world. Need a move of God. We're hungry, we're desperate. Lord, open the heavens. We need a move of God in our life. How many need a move of God? In our homes, we need a move of God. We're hungry, we're desperate. Lord, open the heaven. We need
a move of God.
In word of life,
we need a move of God.
In our children,
we need a move of God.
We're hungry, we're desperate. Lord, open the heaven. Amen, amen.
Amen. We're going to slow things down a little bit. If you guys want to stand, you can. If you don't, then, you know, I just want you to close your eyes, and I just want you to think about the first time you accepted Christ in your life. Amen. I want you to just let him move you.
Caught up in your presence, I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. When I just sang another song, take me back to where we start. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. Caught up in this hole. Oh, I'm not here for blame. nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, Jesus, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. Nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, Jesus, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, and nothing else will do. At your feet, I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not I'm here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me. I just want you. tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So when all things be my life and breath, I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountain, I'll need you to move. When you don't pop the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give me answers as I cry out to you, I will trust in you. I will trust in you.
Hello, family and friends. Deacon Ray here. How many of y'all have seen the show Family Matters? Let me tell you how the family matters to God. The family is a masterpiece of God's creation. Marriage and parenthood reveal God's character. God put children in families so they can experience His love and learn how to love others. And the importance of the family is to be structured in the Word of God. A few years back, I lost my father, and it crippled my family. I was a daddy's boy and wasn't really close with my mother or my sister, and it just divided us. And we went our separate ways in grievement and kind of did our own thing. Jesus says in Mark 3:25, "And a house be divided against itself, it cannot stand." So once the house is divided, the enemy has gain. He has a foothold. I was saved and have been with Word of Life Christian Fellowship. And in doing so, I was able to regain my relationship with my mother and my sister. Thanks be to God. So, what I'm getting at is,
presence. Amen. God is so good. His mercy endures forever. Amen. His truth endures for all generations. Amen. And we will live to tell the story of how we overcome these trials and these tribulations. We will be able to be witnesses for the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. You and I will be witnesses to the truth that we learn from the gospel. And so I'm excited, man. I'll tell you that this is the great life to live. Amen. This is a great life to live, to have a relationship with God. Is, you know, there's a song that says, falling in love with Jesus is the best thing that I've ever done. Amen. And so let's just give God another hand clap of praise. Amen. Thankful for our worship leaders this morning who led us through a song to remind us that, one, we are experiencing a move of God. And then when we come into His presence, we shouldn't be coming here today wanting God to do anything for us. Amen. We ought to just want God. Amen. You ought to be here because, God, I want you above all things. Amen. And Sister Neve remind us that we have to trust in God. And so I know you come here and you got so many things that you're dealing with in your life on a day-to-day basis. But the reminder is that God is still in control. God is still good. God can help you through all of your situations. And so we're grateful for the worship experience because it prepares us for the receiving of the word. It softens and conditions our heart. It cultivates the soil of our heart so that when the seed is being scattered, it falls on good ground. Amen. Amen. And so I'm excited this morning. Just want to make a few announcements and then we'll get into our Holy Communion. So today we will be celebrating our children. Amen. Let's give them a hand for all of their academic achievement for this year. We're going to celebrate them today. Also, on June 10th, we will be beginning our biblical method class. Amen. All of you who have registered and signed up, we're going to have a great time as we go through scripture, learning how to study the Bible, how to prepare lessons and present them. And so if you have a desire to understand the Bible better and you want to join us on this crusade, we welcome you to join us. Just go to the church track and you can register there. On June 12th, we'll begin our youth and our youth Bible studies on Wednesday nights. The children will have their own individual study led by Sister Kendra and Sister Eloisa. And the teens also will have their study, which is led by Sister Kenyatta and Sister Dovey. And so if you're a child or a teen and you're not engaging with the youth, we want to encourage you to get involved. We have a great study plan for you. Amen. And just want to thank the mothers and grandparents also for being so instrumental in helping the children get in place and be prepared for what they're going to do. We're also looking forward to Father's Day. Amen. Father's Day celebration coming up. Our church picnic on June 22nd, we are anticipating to have a great time. The time for the picnic will be, 12 to 6?
Yeah.
12 to 6, and so Kitty Hollow Park, where we were last year. And then one of the highlights of our June this year would be the ordination of Brother Roger O'Neill Davis. Amen. So we are excited about what God is doing in the life of Brother Davis and his entire family. And so I know, Sister Mona, you are proud of your son and seeing God work and move into his life. And so if there's nothing else, I just want to just thank all of you for being here. Those of you who are watching online, if you do me a favor and just share this link with about 5 family members, 5 friends, 5 distant cousins, and maybe 5 co-workers. Amen. And so you just share the link so that we could make sure everybody is present to hear the word of God. Amen. And following our service, we'll have just a small reception for our children as well. Amen. And so as we partake in Holy Communion, we are reminded of the sacrifice that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ had, the sacrifice he made for us on Calvary's cross when he freely and willingly gave his life for us. Jesus took this communion with his disciples. He reminded them that the bread represented the body of Jesus Christ, which was broken on our behalf. And then the blood represents the wine represents the blood of Jesus Christ, which was shed for our sins. Amen. And so we want to just bow our heads for a brief prayer, and then we will commune. Father God, we thank you for this day. We're grateful for your Holy Spirit. We're grateful for your guidance this morning. We thank you for how you strengthen us and how you keep us, God. Through every storm, through every battle, God, you have allowed us to experience victory. And Father, we can't take any credit for this. It's only because of you that we are here. And so, Father, as we partake of the Holy Communion, God, we remember your crucifixion. We remember, Father, that you were beaten, that you were nailed to a cross. We remember, Father, that you shed blood for our sins, and that your blood purchased us and redeemed us from the powers of sin, and you have reconciled us back to God. And we thank you, Father, for everything that you do. And these blessings we ask in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray and say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. If you have the bread, if you would. As we together partake of the bread, let us commune. Let us say amen.
Amen.
And the fruit of the vine, which represents his blood, let us commune. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. I get the privilege this morning to speak a word to our young people. Amen. I've done Bible studies with them on Zoom meetings and sat in with some of them during their teaching, but haven't had the opportunity to preach the Word of God to them. And so I'm excited about them being here this morning in service with us. We call this Big Church. Amen. But we all serve a big God. Amen. And so I want to begin by just letting them know how proud I am of them. Amen. And if they can give me their undivided attention this morning, amen. I want to commend them for being doers of the word. They listen very well, and they learn a whole lot. And I made an exhortation a few weeks ago about cleaning up your TikTok. And immediately, some of our children began to exalt the name of Jesus Christ on their TikToks. And I'm proud of that. Amen. I believe that it's never too young to be a messenger of the Lord. Amen. And that's what my word is about this morning. If you turn with me to Ecclesiastes chapter 12. Ecclesiastes chapter 12. And I don't purpose to preach long. I just want to make some points and give encouragement to our young people. But I want our young adults to pay attention as well. I want our adults to pay attention. It's not a time for you to go to sleep. Amen. I'm still talking to you. And the reason why I'm talking to you too is because some of you are still struggling with this stuff yourself. Amen. And then two, these are your kids. You have to raise them. Amen. You have to make sure that they are getting the information that is given to them from their classrooms or from the pulpit. Amen. And so if you can turn with me to Ecclesiastes chapter 12. I actually preached Ecclesiastes. This was like my second sermon that I've ever preached. So we're talking about 27 years ago, I preached from this particular book. And the sermon title, I hope y'all listening to me. Amen. I'm not real formal. I can be informal, okay? So I preach living life to the fullest because the Ecclesiastic writer encourages us to enjoy our life. And I think the challenge for many young people is that you feel that you can't enjoy life if you are fully committed to God. And I learned that that's not true. You can be young and saved.
Amen.
You could have fun and go to the movies and you could do all the things that brings, you know, satisfaction to your life. The only difference is you have to have clean fun. You got to be mindful of how you live. You got to, you know, there are some things that you can't do. It's kind of like going to a theme park, right? You go to the theme park, there are a bunch of rides in that theme park. But you can't ride every ride that is in there. And, you know, there are some rides that are height requires, right? You can't, if you're under a certain height, you cannot get on that ride. But there are times when you begin to grow in life, there are some things that you can do, but it is an appointed time for you to do those things, okay? So let's look at this scripture here, Ecclesiastes 12:1. And just want to do the A clause of that verse. And the word says, remember also your creator in the days of your youth. You can sit down now. Remember your creator in the days of your what?
Youth.
All right. Remember your creator in the days of your
youth.
Remember what?
Okay.
I'm testing if you're listening. Remember your creator in the days of your
youth.
Remember
in the days
of your youth. Okay. And that's the subject this morning as well. Remember your creator. Okay. Remember your creator. As you get up in the morning, I want to encourage you to remember your creator. Why are you brushing your teeth, washing your face? Remember your creator. When you step out of the door, remember your creator. When you are around your friends, and particularly your unsaved friends or unchurched friends, you do what?
Remember your creator.
When you go out, this is for some of you teenagers and some of the older ones. When you go out and there is this boy or this girl who is googly eyeing you, what are you supposed to do? When you are hanging out and you have friends that has weed, alcohol, and they playing a bunch of crazy stuff, what are you supposed to do? When somebody tells you, come go with me and let's go do something wrong, what are you supposed to do?
Remember your
creator. Keep God on your mind. Never forget your Creator. Never forget God. Never forget God. Always remember your Creator in all situations, under all circumstances. Remember your Creator. Don't forget God. When you're at school, do not forget God. Keep your mind, stay on Jesus. Adults, remember your Creator. Teenagers, remember your Creator. Children,
remember your Creator.
Ladies,
remember your Creator.
Men,
remember your Creator.
Remember God. And this is an amazing book, because when you look at Ecclesiastes and you ask, well, what does Ecclesiastes mean? And Ecclesiastes in the English translation is the English translation of a Hebrew word pronounced Koheleth. I'll spell it for you later. Kohulet. And what this means is one who calls an assembly of students or listeners, or one who is a collector of wise sayings. Okay? And in other words, a simple way of explaining or defining what Ecclesiastes mean, it is preacher. It is preacher or teacher. If you look through the book of Ecclesiastes, you will see that the author identifies himself as the preacher, as the teacher. Doesn't give a name. Psalm says, like Proverbs, that Solomon wrote the book of Ecclesiastes. And many say that Solomon wrote the book of Ecclesiastes, because not only does the person who writes this identify himself as the preacher, but he says that he is the son of David and he was the king of Israel. And then he goes on to talk about how wise he was. And so this is why many people feel that Solomon wrote the book, but more importantly, he was a preacher. He was one who assembled people to hear and to listen. And as he preached the word, and as he taught the word, and we know that a preacher is defined as one who preaches, one who stands before an assembly publicly proclaiming and teaching religious beliefs and a course of action, which is what I'm doing right now. But you know what the problem is with our world today? Is that a lot of people don't listen to the preacher. We don't listen to the preacher. Children does not listen to the preacher enough. Teenagers don't listen to the preacher enough. Adults do not listen to the preacher enough. Parents do not listen to the preacher enough. But it is destined for us to listen to who? The preacher. Because why? The preacher has a collection of wise sayings. And so the message here from Ecclesiastes is to fear God and to live responsibly to Him. And so the question this morning we must ask is, why should we listen to the preacher? And why should we take his advice? And I'm not talking particularly about any preacher, but I'm talking about the preacher who wrote this book.
Yes, sir.
So why should we listen to the preacher? Why should we take his advice? Because he's trying to give young people some sound advice. And this is the best advice that you'll ever get in your life. Okay? So why is it that we should listen to him? And why should we take his advice? The answer is because the preacher is teaching a word that is of divine origin and inspiration.
Yes, sir.
In other words, it's because what he is saying to you is coming directly from God.
Amen.
So God is imparting wisdom that comes from heaven and communicated to us through the preacher. So you ask the question, well, why should I sit here on Sunday mornings and listen to the preacher? It's because what he is saying is of divine origin and inspiration. He's not here just speaking for his help.
Amen. Come on,
he's not saying things that will benefit him, but it's something that comes from God that will benefit you. And this is why I like this, because if you look at Ecclesiastes 12 and 11, and I should have you turn there with me. Matter of fact, go there with me. Let's walk through this quickly. The question was, why should we listen to him and why should we take his advice? It's because, again, the preacher is teaching a word that is of divine origin and inspiration. In other words, it's because what he is saying is coming directly from God. Look at what Ecclesiastes 12 and 11 says. It says, the words of the wise are as goads and as nails fastened by the masters of assembly, which are given from one shepherd. Okay? So why should you listen to me? Because God is talking to you through me.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Amen.
So when you refuse to listen to me or listen to the preacher, who we assume is speaking what God is communicating to us,
yes,
who are we really turning our, clogging our ears to? God. It's important that you understand that, young people. That anytime your parents, your teachers open up the Bible, they are speaking to you from God. These are the words of God. Don't let nobody tell you man wrote the Bible. These are words that came from God that he gave to man to write down, so that you can know them, so that you will know them and that you will understand them, and so that you will live them, because they will help you in the long run.
Right.
Okay? So that's the first answer to the question, why we should listen to him and why should we should take his advice, is because he's speaking God's word. The second reason why we should listen to this preacher is because his wisdom not only comes from his books, but it's from his own experience.
Amen.
So he's not just talking about something that he read. He's talking about something that he lived out. Okay? So he said, because his wisdom is not from only from his books, but it's from his own experience. And it's evident that this preacher has lived long enough, did enough, seen enough, accomplished enough, and failed enough, and knows enough about life to teach us. And let me put a plug there. I think a lot of times we underestimate our elders. They're trying to tell us something, and we don't listen to them because we think that they're old and crazy. We're saying it don't work like that no more, right? We're saying just because it happened to you don't mean that it's going to happen to us. How many adults have said that to your parents? That's your life. Let me live my life. And I think the crazy thing, and I understand it, but I think sometimes it's crazy when you say, let me make my own mistakes. But I get where you're going, you know, because you're saying, I just got to learn. I got to live, and I have to learn for myself. But I don't think you ought to be you know, excited about making mistakes. Because some mistakes you're going to make is not going to be easy to. And so when the old people, the elder people or the old school or the old heads, as some say, starts talking, you should listen. Because they've been there. They've done that. They've been where you are. So they could tell you a thing or two, but you just have to be humble enough to listen. Because his wisdom not only comes from his books, but from his own experience. It is evident that this preacher has lived long enough, did enough, seen enough, accomplished enough, and failed enough, and knows enough about life to teach us. You know, I want somebody who got some experience to be my teacher. Children, your parents have experience. They have been through some things. They have been down the roads that you are now traveling on. The things that you are feeling, you are not the only one or the first one to have those feelings. You like a little boy? Your mama liked a little boy too. She liked your daddy. You like a little girl? Your mama liked it. Your daddy liked a little girl too. Let me get that right. Your daddy liked a little girl too. He liked your mama. So you're not the first one to experience or encounter relationships and heartbreaks and all that stuff. Friends who you thought were real and they betrayed you, you know. You're not the first one to experience that. So when mama and daddy say you need to be careful of the type of company that you keep, and you say, these are my friends, leave them alone. They know, because they've had a few people that have burnt them.
Yes, sir.
They understand. So they're talking to you from experience, and I believe that when experienced people are talking, you ought to be listening. Yes. Because your goal ought to be always, I want to learn something.
Amen.
I want to grow as an individual, and to grow means you have to learn. You can't grow without learning. Okay, so you got to learn something, but in order for you to learn, over here, this cone over here, in order for you to learn, you got to listen. You can't learn nothing if you're not listening. And you'll never learn if you're not willing to listen and take wise advice. And the problem with kids, and I did this when I was young too, I listened more to my friends than I did my own mama. And what do they know? They just like me, right? We ain't got no job, you know, we ain't making no money, we can't drive, you know, we don't know nothing. But we take advice from the people who are in the same boat that we is. At the end of the day, we all gotta go home and do what our mama tell us to do. And we're sitting here having these grown folk conversations as kids, trying to do grown folk things as kids, when we really need to be doing is going home, cleaning up our rooms, washing dishes, taking our trash and doing some chores, doing your homework, get ready for school. You get what I'm saying? I'm trying to help your parents this morning. Don't listen to your friends. Your friends do not have a degree in life. You listening? Do not listen to your friends. They don't know. They taking orders just like you. Man, I'm tired of taking orders, man. I can't wait till I get grown and get out of this house. You got a long way to go. But then still, when you get old enough to get your own place, then you don't leave. You stay home.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But before that, you was anxious to get out and get your own spot. And the truth of the matter is, what you really want is freedom to do your own thing.
Yes, sir.
And I'm telling you, this old saying, don't believe the hype. It ain't all as hyped up as it seemed to be. Don't let these rappers fool you. All right? Don't let them fool you. Because most of them are kind of speaking lies anyway. They're just telling stories. And I saw this. Listen to me. I saw this, and some of the older ones can understand. So I saw where, and then people make these expressions about rappers whose children turn out to be different than the people who listen to, the kids who listen to their music, right? So that says, while Jeezy had us out here trapping, his son was getting a college degree. You get what I'm saying? So they are telling you and they are talking about things and encouraging you to do things that they probably really don't even do themselves. All right. So why am I saying all this to you? I'm saying this to you so you can stop listening to them and start listening to us. We've had enough heartaches. We've had enough pain. We done been through some stuff. We done made some choices. We've suffered the consequences of those choices. And some of us in here could write a book about all the things that we've been through. Yes, sir. But if you would just be wise enough, courageous enough, and brave enough to sit down and give us your undivided attention, yes, yes, you can be good. Oh, yes. You can do well. And it's always our intention for you to do better than we have done.
Yes, sir.
For you to be better than we have. So you can have your business together, you can have your finances together, you can have your house together. But you have to stick to what you were taught growing up. You cannot grow out of love with Jesus. That love that y'all have for Jesus Christ right now, I pray that you keep that love.
Yes, sir.
I pray that it never changes. I pray that when you get older and you are confronted with life, that you remember your Creator.
Yes, sir.
And so the question now I ask is, what is his experience taught him that he's so eager to teach us? Because not many people, hey buddy, I told you I'm informal, it's all good. Hey buddy, how you doing, man? All right, amen. Amen. The kids don't bother me. I'm telling you, they don't bother me. I just want them to listen, amen, to the word of God. Amen. And so what is it that this preacher has learned that he wants us to learn, right? You know, because every time we learn a lesson, you know, we ought to be wanting to share it with somebody else,
yes, sir,
right? You know, because we should always have this passion for our children to always go in the right direction. And when you see kids going wrong, you know, you want to share some lessons, right? So what is it that his experience has taught him that he's so eager to teach us? And the answer here is that his experience has taught him that the best thing about life is having a relationship with the one who created it. That's the best thing about life. It gets no better than this. This has everlasting results.
Amen.
When you hear them say, only what you do for Jesus Christ is last, that's not something that we're making up.
Yeah.
That is actually in Scripture.
Yes, it is.
Where it says, flowers fade, the grass fades, and everything withers. The only thing that stands and remains is God's Word. So at the end of the day, The only true value of life is a relationship with God. Now imagine that. All these rich people in the world, all these people who have almost all the material things that their hearts can desire. But you know what they don't have? They don't have God. And if they don't have God, they're not complete. And I'm not just saying this because if you look around, how many rich people are killing themselves? How many people who have everything they can want in life and yet they still seem kind of sad, yes. Depressed, unhappy, mental health issues? Why? Because many of them don't have a relationship with God. And if they got themselves in situations, let's say if they do have a relationship with God and they got themselves in situations, they fail to remember their Creator. Because you can encounter a situation or an experience, but if you just remember your Creator, then your outcome can be different. And that's why I always love Psalms 1, where it says, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. He doesn't stand in the way of sinners, and he doesn't sit in the seat of scoffers. But it says that his delight is in the law of the Lord. Okay? That means he loves God's word. And then because he loves God's word, that scripture says in his law, he meditates. He spends some time reading it, studying it, memorizing it. You know, what does this mean? And they say, in this law, he meditates day and night. That emphasizes that he spends a lot of time doing it. How many of you want to know God's word? By show of hands. You can do it. But it's going to cost you time. You're going to have to meditate on it day and night. Just like you got to know your friends. The only reason why you can tell me so much about your best friend is because you spent a lot of quality time with that individual. And that person told you things about themselves. And you learned some things about them by spending time with them. Okay? And so his experiences taught him that the best thing about this life is having a relationship with the one who created. It does not matter what you do with your life. If you're not pursuing a relationship with God, nothing else matters. Doesn't matter what you do with your life. If you're not pursuing a relationship with God, it does not matter. I got married. You got a relationship with God? I bought my first house. You got a relationship with God? I got me a bad ride. You got a relationship with God? I went to college and I got me a doctor's degree. Do you have a relationship with God? I am a proud father. I'm a proud grandfather. I'm a proud husband. I'm a proud son. But if I don't have a relationship with God, nothing else matters. Because this scene as you see it is going to pass. I was talking about theme parks earlier, right? One of the theme parks that we went to when we were kids was called Astroworld. But it's gone. It's gone. It's not here no more. So what I'm saying is, what's today, it's not promised. Tomorrow is something else. Yes, sir. One day this is in style. Tomorrow another trend is gone. And things change all the time. But you know, the one thing that has been consistent in all generations that has never changed, can you guess what that is? God. God has not changed. He has remained the same. He has been the same. And he will always be the same. And in his word, he says, I never change. And his word never changed. So you can't sit here and say, well, this was just for the old people. We got a new book now that we get our life lessons from. You know, we reading from other books, you know, some other stuff that we, you know, we want to change our setting. You know, we don't think we should go to church. You know, that's outdated. Things are changing now. We don't have to go to church. But the word says, I never change. And his word never changed. And so his experience has taught us that it doesn't matter what you do with your life. If you're not pursuing a relationship with God, nothing else matters. And I think it's important for us parents to know that, because right now these kids are not in control. So whatever they do or don't do in God, that's on you. If you don't expose them to it, they're not going to get it. Come on. You know, I think our kids are unique here. Mm-hmm. They hunger for the word. Yeah. But that's not the average kid, right? Because let's be honest, adults don't always hunger for it like they should. Mm-hmm. So if you're not hungry, you're not going to make sure they eat.
Yes, sir.
If it's not important to you, and at some point, and listen, at some point, and I'm telling you what I know and what I've seen, okay? At some point, if you don't make God a priority in your house, and if you don't make this experience for them a priority in your house, even though they may want to do it right now, and sometimes our children wants it more than we want it.
Yes.
But the problem is they don't have the keys to the car. I wish they could drive. You know what I mean? So that they could drive themselves to church and not have to depend on parents to bring them. But here's the thing. At some point, if you don't show a passion for it and make it a responsibility, at some point they're going to be exposed to enough stuff in the world that's going to captivate their mind and their attention. And at some point they're going to fall out of love with Jesus themselves. And then when they get to an adult age, then you want to start training them. Let me talk to you now. You're going to want to start training them when they're adults. And now it's too late to do it. And now you're going to start telling them, y'all need to go to church. Y'all need to get right with God. Y'all need to get saved. You don't need to be listening to all of that. But from 5 years old all the way to 18 years old, you didn't make that a priority. And so now, I've been saying, bring your kid to church.
Yes.
We miss these babies. Bring them here so we can teach them.
Yes.
And you won't bring them. But when they get older and they start doing stuff, getting in stuff, going to, you know, getting themselves, you know, in trouble, then you're going to be calling me. Pastor, you got time to talk to these kids?
Yeah.
And I'm going to say, if they ain't listening to you, they ain't listening to me. I tried to talk to them when they was babies, when we could control the situation.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can't control a teenager, man. You got to do it, say, train up a child. That's from when they were a little baby, when they come into this world. Look here, man, you're going to go to church, little man. All right? That's it. They don't make those choices. They don't. God gave you that responsibility.
Amen.
And I'm telling you, they can't get here if you don't drive them here. You know? Let that sink some a little bit, parents. Grandparents, GGs, and nannies, and pawpaws, and, you know? Let that stuff sink a little bit. You know? If you don't get them here, they ain't coming. Pastor, I wanted to come, but, you know, my mama was tired. My mama, I ain't gonna mess with y'all. I don't know y'all like that. And so why should we listen to him? And I'm gonna go ahead and wrap this up because of time. But why should we listen to him? Why should we be eager to listen to him? It's because he knows something about life. Okay, he knows something about life. All right? Second is because his experience has taught him that our choices have consequences. Okay? If I put my hand in a fire, what's going to happen? It's going to what? It's going to hurt? Burn my hand. Right? If I came to you with a burnt hand, you're going to ask me what?
Why?
What happened to your hand, Pastor? What's going on? And I tell you a story that, you know what, one day I was being foolish and I was playing with the fire. And I just put my hand because I was curious. And I started doing like that. And felt cool at first, but then I burnt my hand, right? If I told you that. Now, here's my question. Would you go play with fire after I told you that story? You're saying no. You're saying no, right? And the truth of it is, I mean, that's the right choice. The truth of it is, just in other things in life, if I told you I went through this and this happened to me, then why would you just ignore that? You know what I'm saying? Now, it's no guarantee that our experience is going to be the same. That's not the point. The point is, I think you should at least take caution. You should at least think about it. And that's when you start getting advice from people, you have to remember who? Your Creator. You got to remember your Creator.
Yes, sir.
And what that means is to keep God on your mind. Remember, He created you. Okay? Remember why He created you. To worship Him. To live for Him. Okay? To represent Him. When He created you in His image, in His likeness, He designed you to represent Him to the world. But if there's no proper representation at home, I can't expect for these kids to get it. You know, the representation and what I'm teaching has to be in the parents' mind. You know, and the parents has to feed it to the kids.
Yes,
and here's the other thing, and one of the things, when I close that means I'm done. So the other thing is, what we try to do here is put our entire church on a diet. We just look at it like that, since we're talking about healthy living, right? We try to put the whole church on a diet. So that means we have a Bible study plan for everybody, right? And at one point when we first started, we were teaching the kids the same thing that we were teaching the adults. But you know what our intent was? We did that so that on the way home or after the studies that parents can sit down at the table with their kids and talk about the lesson together. So y'all talked about God's Spirit, you know, God, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit today. We talked about that too. What did y'all learn? And that's the question we always asked our kids when they were small, when they got out of their little Bible studies. What y'all learned today? Because they wanted to eat. What we eating? So when we got in the car, what we eating? And we would hit up French's every Tuesday night, man. You know, what we eating? What you learn today? Now, what you learn today? You know, what did you learn today, Deacon? Listen to our Creator. What did you learn today, Brother Adrian?
See my Creator would, and feed the kids from an early age.
Amen. Amen. This is Sister Ursula's son, Brother Adrian, my brother-in-law, First Lady's brother, Sister W's brother. Thank you for being here today with us. Amen. What did you learn today, Riley?
To remember Creator.
To remember your Creator. What did you learn, buddy? Yes, sir, you. To remember your Creator. What you learned today? Yes. Remember our Creator. And then as Sister Erica prepares to come, you remember your Creator now in the days of your youth. Don't wait till you get old. Don't say, I'm going to sow all my wild oats. I'm going to do everything in life that I can do because I just don't have time for a relationship with God right now. Don't be that person. Don't wait till you get old. Don't wait till your hair start getting gray. Don't wait till your teeth start falling out. Don't wait till you can't stand up straight and you have to start pushing a walker. Do not wait till you just lose interest in life. Do it now. Serving God right now is the best time in your life to serve God. You know why? Because there are things that you could do in the prime of your life because you got the energy to do it. You got the brain to do it. And there are things that you could do that they can't do. And perhaps they waited till they got old to want to be a super saint now, to be a missionary for God and try to save the whole world, but now they can't because they got to pack babies, grandkids, and you know, they don't have the energy to do it. But guess who have it? You. You have it. You could turn the world upside down with your Christian influence. So remember your Creator now. In the days of your youth, don't wait till you get old. Do it now. Don't put it off. Do it now. Do it when?
Now.
Now, while you're young. Because he says here that youth and childhood is vanity. Yes. It's like a chasing of the wind. I am young. I am enjoying myself. I'm just going to do me. I don't have a worry in the world. I don't have no bills. I don't have nothing. God can wait. This Bible stuff, it can wait. I don't need it. But then when you start getting older, you start experiencing hurt and pain and sorrow, confusion, and all these issues that people are having. Mm-hmm. And then now you need God. But you can say, God, I need you. It's okay. God, I need you. I need you while I'm young. I need you while I'm a teenager.
Yes, sir.
I need you while I'm an adult. I need you when I'm old. Because God, I figured it out. I cannot do it without you. I tried it, but I can't do it without you.
Yes, sir.
Amen. God bless you.
Prepare my mind.
the strength to pass any test. I know that I am, know that I am, know that I'm so blessed. With you in control of my life, I'm king. I'm gonna be because you live deep inside of me.
I'm gonna be ready.
Because I know it's your will for me to be ready. I'm gonna be, whoa,
amen, amen, amen. Let's praise God for Sister Erica. You know, if you didn't know, I've been knowing Erica ever since she was a child. Amen, and she spent her entire life in the house of God. And blessed to be part of a godly family. Amen, and so I'll just want to say to our children as First Lady comes, and I believe Sister Eloisa as well, as they come. Well, actually, let's take up our offering. Amen. But as we prepare to give this morning, we want to thank God for being our first giver. Amen. We wouldn't be able to give if he had not first given. And he has taught us the principle of giving. And that's one of the things that I want to commend Sister Dovey and Sister Eloisa for, and all those who work with the children for, because they teach the children how to give. Amen. They teach them how to give, and they teach them how to worship God. They teach them how to love God. And this is not something that they do on their own. This is something that we have to teach them. And so we thank those of you who've already given throughout the week for toward the regular givings and toward the building fund as well. Thank you for your contribution. And I want to commend you, and I want to encourage all of us, amen, to be faithful with the things that God has given us, to be better stewards, amen, and be a giver, amen, be a giver. Amen. Be a giver. Amen. And so just want to say to our children again that I love you. I praise God for you. And so proud of you. And I want you to make sure that you always remember your Creator. Amen. Remember your Creator. Don't lose sight of God, because God never loses sight of you. Amen. Don't stop loving God, because God will never stop loving you. Amen. He'll always be there for you as you, I was thinking about Riley. Riley would be going to middle school, and I connected with the children and asked, what can I pray? And she says, pray as she transitioned. And I can imagine that could probably be a scary thing for her. But the thing that is constant, Riley, is that God is with you everywhere you go. Amen. Amen. And you're going to do well in middle school. Amen. Welcome to middle school, kid. Amen. Amen. And she will also be joining the teens ministry soon as well. Amen. The children will be losing their leader. She's the president of the youth ministry. Children's ministry. Yeah, I give Sister President Riley a hand. Amen. And so now I'm going to turn it over to First Lady. Let's give First Lady a hand as she comes. Amen.
Thank you. Again, we are just happy for our children and for all they have accomplished in school this school year, so we wanted to just make sure that we recognize them. We know that, you know, school is much different from when we were all in there. And they go through a lot of, you know, tough things. I mean, the curriculum is even tougher than when we were in school. And so, but we want them to know that we love them and that we are very proud of the hard work that they've done this school year. And I think everybody's pretty much out of school, I think, just about. So, okay. So, but just we want you to know that, you know, we are happy for you and we want you to enjoy your summer, but just remember your Creator this summer and when you start school for the next school year in the fall. So at this time, I'm going to ask Sister Eloisa to join me up here. She is your teacher. And the name's on the bag. And so as I call your name, I want you to come up and I want you to stand up here and you'll just stand in a row. We'll do the children first and then we'll move to our teens after we finish with the children, I'm sorry. And so first we want to call Jalea up. Y'all give her a hand as she comes to encourage her. And stand here. Jalea is, stand on the floor for me. Okay, thank you. Jalea received several awards this school year. She received the Social Studies Award, Appreciation Award, Participation Award, Resilience in Math Certificate of Achievement Award, Reading Achievement, Scoring at Above Benchmark Reading Level, and Language Arts for Grammar and Mechanics of Writing. And she's been promoted to the fifth grade. Let's give her a hand. Thank you. Next, we have Joseph. As we all know, JoJo and her twin. All right, Joseph received an award in Math for Participation Excellence, Reading Certificate, Language Arts Certificate, Social Studies Certificate, Science Certificate, A and B Honor Roll all year, and Perfect Attendance. Let's give Joseph a hand, and he's being promoted to the fifth grade as well. Amen. Bailey. All right, let's give Bailey a hand. Bailey is being promoted to the third grade. Bailey received awards, Excellence in Science, and a Citizenship Award. Amen. Ayana. As we all know, it's Nana. All righty, Nana received awards, a Social Butterfly Award, Leadership Award, Reading Rock Star Award. Ayana is reading on a fifth grade level. Terrific Team Player Award, Marvelous Mathematician Award, and Multiplication Master Award. Ayana is being promoted to the fourth grade. Mason. Let's give Mason a hand. He's being promoted to the first grade. All right, Mason. Eric. All right, Eric. Eric is being promoted to the third grade. Eric received award certificate for excellent effort, for never giving up and always giving full effort in everything that he does. He's received an award for good character and for a team player. All right, Eric, congratulations. David. David is being promoted to the fourth grade. Man, congratulations. And we save the last for least because we have Miss Riley, who actually graduated from the fifth grade and is moving from elementary school to middle school, so she will be starting sixth grade in the fall. We are so proud of her. I felt it was great to have Sister Eloisa give her gift since she will be moving from her class to the teens class. So this is her last I want to cry. She's getting old. She's growing up so fast. But we are so proud of all of you all. You took a picture of them? I'm going to step to the side here so we can get a group picture.
I'll take a picture with.
Oh, okay. Okay, and so wait, before you guys leave, your teacher, Sister Eloisa, has some encouraging words that she would like to share with you before you sit down.
All righty, my babies. I know they're not babies, and I do thank them for even saying, letting me even say that I can call them my babies. I just want you guys to... I'm not. Okay, so back in my days, so I remember when I was in school, we would sign each other's yearbooks. I don't know if y'all guys get yearbooks anymore. Oh, okay, no, okay. Well, back in when they did that to us, we would write stuff like, don't change, stay cool, you know, just little funny things we would say. What I want to say to you today is, number one, I want you guys to always, and it's so funny because I wrote this like 2 weeks ago, to keep God in your life. So basically what Pastor has taught us today. Number two comes from my quote, don't ever change. Don't ever change is not the way to live at all. If you don't change, then you will never grow. Growing is very, very important. I pray I have poured water into your life because you guys have poured tons of water into my life. I know that some of you might be leaving me soon, but you'll be in the other classroom. You might be leaving my class, but you'll never leave my heart.
Okay, next we have our teens, and we are proud of our teens as well. The first name we have is Nevaeh. Nevaeh's being promoted to the sixth grade, and I'm going to let her announce her certificate that she had received from school.
I went to a college field trip, and they had me do a couple classes of robotics, diesel, technical engineering, and electrical voltage, and I aced all my classes, so they gave me an award saying that I'm a junior technical engineer at the school.
Woo! All right. Thank you, Nevaeh. Next, we have Kylie. Kylie's being promoted to the eighth grade, and she took all AP classes and was on A&B honor roll all year. All right, congratulations, Kylie. And next we have Ryan, who's being promoted to the 11th grade. All right, she's still in school. She doesn't get out till this week, so okay.
I passed all my finals with A's and B's, and I passed all my star tests.
All right, thank you. We do want to make mention Lily, that's been promoted to the seventh grade, and she received made A on a roll all year, and she received the Citizenship Award. And we do want to also, let's give Lily a hand. She's absent, but they're watching online, so I did not want to miss them. And then we also want to congratulate Bryce as well, who's being promoted to the eighth grade. So congratulations to them too as well. And I will let Sister Debbie Fort will give some words of encouragement to her group as well.
Amen. So proud of my teens. We have a unique class because we got older people 19 and 20 year olds in our class as well, but we're acknowledging the ones that are still in school. And I just want to encourage you to keep going. And as Pastor said, you know, we got people who want to encourage you to do the wrong things, but you know who your Creator is, and that should encourage you to do the right thing. And we're proud of you. Oh, I'm sorry. We're proud. Sister Kenyatta and I are very proud, and we thank God. Sorry, I keep forgot we online. Thank God that we get to teach you, because I teach high school, and believe me, I see some things y'all don't want to know about. So I thank God. Always keep God on your mind. That's what Pastor said in the message. Keep Him on your mind at all times, and that will help you to do the right things. So again, I'm proud of you. I love you, and we can't wait to get back in class, because it's been a minute since we've been teaching. So we just thank God for the opportunity that Pastor has given us to be able to teach you. Thank you.
Thank you. So before you guys have a seat, our pastor is going to pray over our youth, and then we will dismiss from there.
All right, let's give them another hand clap of praise. Thank God for them. Amen. I want to ask if they turn toward me. I want to ask if you stand, and we'll give the benediction as well. If you stand, if you want to come close, you can, just to help them to feel our support and love this morning. Amen. They are some amazing people of God, and God has created them for His purpose. Amen. We get them involved in a lot of things, but let's remember, God created them for His purpose. These are His kids. And our primary responsibility as parents is to raise them in God's way. Amen. Amen. Not ours. Amen. You can put them on football teams. You can put them in all kind of stuff. That's fine. But you make sure you don't put that above God. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we thank You for the visitation of Your Holy Spirit. We thank You for Your guidance this morning. Thank You for giving us these children. Thank You for creating them in Your image and in Your likeness, and establishing them and ordaining them that they may go forth and speak of Your praises, to live before You upright, to demonstrate love, to demonstrate good character, to demonstrate wisdom and understanding with their lifestyle. We pray, Father, that first, just to thank You for all of their academic achievements. Thank You for touching their minds and helping them pass tests and learning different curriculums. Thank You, Father, for just keeping them when it seems tough for them and they didn't think that they could do it. God, thank You for surrounding them with wonderful parents and grandparents and family members and church family that remind them that they are beautiful and that they are God's chosen people, that they are royal, that they are peculiar, they're different, and that they can do anything through Christ Jesus who strengthens them. I pray, Father, that as they leave today, that they remember their Creator, that they remember the words that was given to them today, and that they don't ever forget it, but they remember it for the rest of their life. And when others forsake them and when they are alone, I pray that they remember that they have You. And when life gets hard, that there's not a problem that You cannot solve. And if they get in trouble, that You are a good lawyer, Father, and that You are an advocate, Father, of Your people, and You love us. And Your blood was sprinkled for them too. So I pray for Your peace to be with them. I pray for Your joy to be with them. I pray that You continue to protect them, provide for them, and just help them to persevere in all things, God. We thank you for their parents. We thank you for this church and these friends and leaders and teachers. We thank you for all that you pour in them so that they could pour into your children. And so we elevate you today. We give you the highest honor and the praise because they would not be anything without you. And we thank you, Father. We thank you for the service, worship, and all of the sentimental expressions and things that we felt in our heart today as we heard the worship songs and as we heard the preach word. I pray that we cherish these things in our heart and we ponder them in our minds, and that when we leave, they don't leave us, but they remain in us and grow until we become practical with it. Now to him who's able to keep us from falling, may he present us faultless before his throne until we all meet again. Let's say amen.
Amen.
Amen. You're dismissed. Amen. Thank you for joining us online. May God bless you and keep you. It's my prayer.
You build your church and the kingdom.